It's a great pleasure to present some recent work from the Centre for Rapid and Sustainable Product Development, part of the Polytechnic of Leiria in the central region of Portugal. And this is on creating polymeric materials at the point of fabrication of products. This is work performed in partnership with Jean Pinheiro, Daniel da Silva, Saba Abdulgani, Paula Freire, and Artur Mateus. The work was performed at the Centre for Rapid and Sustainable Product Development, which is a centre of excellence in the field of direct digital manufacturing. And the work was supported by national funds from the Foundation for Science and Technology in Portugal. So before we start thinking about how to create new materials, let's just think about how we manufacture things today. If we want to make a complex product, for example, a car, so here I show an exploded view of a Volkswagen Golf GTI, we manufacture the product by manufacturing many different components, usually made from a single uniform material, and then assemble those components into the complex product. This methodology leads directly to having long development paths, because we need to develop the material, then we need to develop the complex and costly tooling to produce each part. So to make the body panels or to make the plastic parts, we need molds. And for the metal parts, we need dies and stamps. And so because of this complex and costly tooling, it makes mass production a necessity to recover the tooling costs. The tooling costs may be more than $1 million. So making 1 million cars, it only contributes $1 per car. Now, the success of this approach has meant that we can produce millions of products manufactured at a price that we can all afford. But what it doesn't allow is it doesn't allow any scope for personalized products other than for the trivial changes to the trim in the case of a car or in some other product. Now let's fast forward to a factory of the future. This factory is a digital manufacturing factory, and so it manufactures products, and the products it manufactures can be configured differently from day to day. And so the digital definition of the factory can change, and it can be reconfigured in terms of the machines and the supply lines to produce anything. So let's think in this, and this factory manufactures products using direct digital manufacturing. So let's think briefly about a particular product. We have this mallet or hammer, and we can think about direct digital manufacturing. Now, direct digital manufacturing is part of the fourth industrial revolution, which many believe is how all things will be made in the future. And this takes a digital definition, a computer file, a CAD file, for example, and uses a range of different technologies to produce the finished part directly without requiring any specific tooling or molds or other components. And the products that are produced can be have a range of applications and can be very, they have a range of applications. The figure on the right shows the Prime Minister of Portugal, Antonio Costa, holding up an object at the opening of the building I showed you at the start, which is the symbol of the Polytechnic of Leiria. Now, the Centre for Rapid and Sustainable Product is a lead institute in a national program concerned with Portuguese additive manufacturing initiative. Now, direct digital manufacturing can manufacture any self-supporting structure. And the picture on the right of the screen is a small statuette of myself, it taken, built, fabricated by using information from a 3D scan of myself. And as the definition of the object is digital, it can be adjusted immediately prior to fabrication. So it could be, instead of a statuette of me, it could be of one of my colleagues, or it could be modified, the statuette. And because of this opportunity to be able to adjust immediately prior to fabrication, it leads direct digital manufacturing leads directly to mass customization. That's the form or the shape of the product can be fixed at the point of fabrication. Now, when we think direct digital manufacturing can manufacture any self-supporting structure, what exactly does this mean? Now, probably when each of us was a child, we learned how to trace round our hand with a pen onto a piece of paper, and then we cut out the shape of the hand, and we had a piece of paper that had the shape of a hand. But of course, it wasn't a hand, it was just something that had the shape of the hand, because unless that object has all of the complexity of the structure of the hand, the bones, the muscle, the nerves, the cartilage, then it doesn't have the function of a hand. And so if we want to be able to make objects which have that level of complexity, we need to be able to make complex shapes, complex patterns of composition and property, different scales of structure, and probably new materials. So let's think about a full digital definition, not the definition that just contains the shape. So a full digital definition will contain the external shape and, as well, the internal distribution of composition of materials and their properties in order to define the function of each part of the product. So this will ensure that both the form and the function are defined at the point of manufacturing. So because they exist in a digital file, defining both the shape and the function and the properties, then this can be switched before the point of manufacturing. And so it is defined at the point of manufacturing. Now, I'm going to give an example of this, and we're going to focus on the direct digital manufacturing technology known as fused deposition modeling, in this in which a strand of polymer is passed through an extruder, the material is melted and extruded through a nozzle and deposited onto a build platform, and the structure is built up by layer by layer. The images on the right show a larger scale pellet-fed extruder system that can be used for making larger objects. It's taken from within the laboratories at the Center for Rapid and Sustainable Product Development. And you can clearly see the layer by layer nature of the build system. Now, digital design of properties. What do we mean by this? Well, if we take the mallet, which we saw at the beginning, then this particular one has a soft outer handle to provide a comfortable grip. It has a shaped handle, but of course that shaped handle could be personalized to suit a particular user, so a large hand or a small hand. It needs to have a tough shaft to be able to withstand the forces exerted on it. In this particular design, the head of it is a separate object and the two are assembled together, as with the outer handle, but this all could be made in one piece design. The head and the head shape and the head surface could be modified to suit the use. So if it's to be used by an orthopedic surgeon or in building, then different tools would be required. The weight of the head could be modified to suit the application. So there's, even in a simple object like this, there are already opportunities for customization and personalization and having different material properties in different parts of the product. Now, the implementation of a digital design of properties in a direct digital manufacturing technology is really quite complicated. We can envisage a multi-material print head, so it has one printer that prints a hard material, another print head that prints a soft material, or we could even use mixed direct digital manufacturing technology, so we could use stereolithography as well as a fused deposition modeling. But in this case, the properties are not really defined at the point of manufacturing, but it provides a discrete selection of properties. So we're choosing between whether we use printhead A or printhead B. This is really choosing between two fixed sets of properties. And this may be essential where particular functions are required. If we need to be able to have an electrically conducting material or a piezoelectric material. But in other applications, for example, in biomedical implants, where we need to match the properties of the implant to the tissue that is being implanted in, the variation that's between materials which we're selecting from may be too coarse. So we've adopted a different approach. And this approach involves the use of a single material suited to the application. And we will use inline processing to vary the properties of the deposited material. So we will use a single material, but we will deposit it in different ways in which it has different properties. And of course, this approach could be expanded to other controls and processing parameters other than the ones that I report here. Now, in this case, the properties are defined at the point of manufacturing. The properties can be varied continuously from soft to hard, from stiff to flexible. And the use of the same materials avoids complications of weak interfaces between materials deposited under varying conditions in different parts of the product. So just to emphasize, the properties are defined at the point of manufacturing. The properties can be varied continuously, and the use of the same material avoids complications of weak interfaces. So to describe this part of the work, I'm going to introduce a collaborative project between the Center for Rapid and Sustainable Product Development, Polytechnic of Leiria, and the Alba Synchrotron Light Source in Barcelona. The pictures show the external of the synchrotron source and some of us at the facility. We will make use of extruder-based polymer 3D printing. Here we show a hexagon being printed, and we will see that towards the end of the presentation. Now, to make progress and to understand what's happening during the 3D printing, we've developed a specific 3D printer that can mount on the small angle and wide angle X-ray scattering beam line, the beam line 11 NCD suite at the Alba Synchrotron light source. And we use this to quantitatively evaluate the molecular organization of the polymer at different points along the strand after it's extruded from the extruder and as it cools down on the build platform. And so we do this by positioning the extruder so the beam, X-ray beam, intersects the extruded strand at different points. So close to the exit of the extruder, the polymer will be molten at a relatively high temperature, and the small angle scattering shows there's no very specific structure there, as would be expected for a liquid. Then as we lower the position of the X-ray beam to a lower point in the extruded strand where it's now cooler, then we start to the material starts to solidify. In this particular case, it starts to form crystals. And in this particular case, the crystal structure is developed with some anisotropy. So we can see that the scattering is different in the vertical direction and in the horizontal direction. And when we reach room temperature, then we can see the fully completed structure. Now we have done experiments with two materials. I'm just going to concentrate on the first one, polycaprolactone. This is a biocompatible semi-crystalline polymer widely used in medical devices and in implants. And this has a point, if we cool the system down, the onset of crystallization is around 38 degrees Celsius. We've also looked at low-density polyethylene, which has a crystallization temperature closer to 100. Now, the right-hand side shows a schematic of the apparatus, the 3D printer with the control mechanisms and such things. We show an infrared camera to intercept, to image the extruded strand to measure the temperature. And on the left-hand side, we show a plot of the temperature against the position from the extruded nozzle. And so we can see that the temperature drops down as we move away from the nozzle, as the strand is extruded. Now, we've plotted this for a variety of different extrusion temperatures. And so if we have an extrusion, extruded temperature of 75, it goes quite a long way down before it reaches this red dashed line. Now, this red dashed line is the crystallization temperature, which we saw in the previous slide for the polycaprolactone. And this is at this point, it solidifies. If we go to a lower extrusion temperature, 45, you can see it reaches solidification at a much higher point in the extrudate. So we can vary the behavior by varying the temperature of the extruded plastic. Now, why though do we see a formation of an anisotropic molecular organization? Well, the material is extruded through a nozzle, which has a length to diameter ratio, which is designed to induce an extension in the longest molecular chains. So these chains are stretched out. If the material, as it cools, reaches the point of crystallization with these extended chains still intact, in other words, not relaxed, then they will act as a row nucleus to template and nucleate chain-folded lamellar crystals with a common lamellar orientation, as shown in the schematic at the bottom, labeled row nucleus. If, on the other hand, it reaches a temperature where crystallization is initiated, and those extended chains have relaxed, then spherulites may form and there will be an isotropic distribution in the system. The left-hand schematic shows how we can vary the way, the morphology in which the material is deposited by changing the processing parameters at different points in the sample. The right-hand picture shows the 3D printer mounted on the Sachs wax beam line. And what we're seeing in the two images, these are videos. They're not videos in time, they're videos in position along this strand. So we're showing that how the morphology develops along the strand. And if we do it with a low extrusion rate, we can see that we get this continuous scattering in a circle with a couple of points of higher intensity. Whereas if we do it at a higher extrusion rate, we simply see a two intensities along the vertical direction. So these two systems have different levels of preferred orientation. Now we can take these X-ray scattering patterns and we can extract out quantitative information about them, and we're going to extract out an orientation parameter, 0 if it's isotropic, 1 if it's perfectly aligned. And this shows the plot of orientation against the distance from the nozzle, and you can see by varying the collector velocity, that's the rate in which the material is deposited onto the build platform, then we can see that we can position the orientation to develop at a later point in the strand, and also the crystallization deposits in a later point in the strand. Now we can collect all those results, and they're presented here where we varied the extrusion velocity, how much material is extruded from the nozzle, and the build platform rotation. And so by choosing different combinations of these parameters, we can vary the level of anisotropy that's present in the strand when it's deposited onto the build platform. Now, materials which have a different level of preferred orientation show different mechanical properties. So here we show two strands with a different yield point, different yield strain. And let's think why this works. So we have an extruded strand that is built, is deposited onto the build platform in a continuous strand, shown in this schematic, in which we've colored different regions into with different colors. And so the red, the green, and the blue could correspond to different levels of stiffness, or corresponding to different level of orientation. And because it's the same material, then there are no interfaces that will be weak and break. And so we can make a product. Now, the variation and modulus that we can write in this particular material, in this particular situation, vary from 700 to 1400 megapascals. So we can vary the properties of the material as we're making the object. And going returning to the hexagon you saw at the beginning, then this is manufactured as an open lattice structure, as might be used in a tissue engineering implant. We've also prepared solid objects. And this, the properties of this is varying continuously from the radio, from the center to the external line. And this is becoming stiffer as we move out in the space. This is an object which is a few centimeters across. And so to summarize, we've utilized the influence of the inline processing parameters in a fused deposition additive manufacturing process to define the level of preferred alignment of the lamellar crystals in the semicrystalline polymer, such as PCL, and also in polyethylene, to produce different levels of properties. We've produced shapes on a centimeter scale, but we've written a structural variation at the nanometer scale with spatial variations on the millimeter scale. We can utilize this multi-scale manufacturing design and optimize properties of novel objects and its performance during use. And so we could produce objects with stiffer parts, weaker parts, in different parts of the product. And so we have been able to produce materials with different properties at the point of manufacturing, of fabrication. And so this is the ultimate digital definition. Thank you very much.